Okay.
Hey, black man.
Hey, what's up?
Well, I'll tell you what's up. Right now, look, you know, we're in the time of COVID. Now, people are not taking this. Some people are not taking this seriously. However, you know, I've had a medical background. People don't understand this, but I had a medical background in the service. I used to be a lab technician, and I've always had an interest in medicine. So now I've got some teas here that I'm going to take. I do at night, usually, because, you know, sometimes people do tea all the time. I do it in the morning. But now I'm doing it at night. Now it's night right now. You're an hour ahead of me, but, you know. So let me tell you what I got. I got Egyptian licorice tea.
Okay.
Right? And I already made the hot water. So I'm just doing dip it in there. Now, this is just straight hot water and Egyptian licorice. As you probably...
It's in a tea bag, right?
It's in a tea bag. Sorry, man. I actually do... The funny thing is, when I'm in South Africa, I do have loose tea. I have a whole system that I use down there, but whatever. But here's what also I got. I got this fancy tea. It's got this weird... I don't know. It's like this mesh triangular-like thing. It's like expensive tea. You know, I picked it up someplace. I forgot where I picked it up from. I think I was in, New York? No, I'll forget. Virginia, New York, someplace. This is, this is a licorice and ginger. So I'm a ginger addict.
All right.
So I put that, this licorice
in. My ginger.
There it is. But you know, ginger, you're supposed to do, here's what people understand. You're supposed to, ginger and garlic has the same properties.
Yeah.
So you're supposed to do, actually you're supposed to do ginger in the morning because you don't want to be garlicky all day. And garlic at night, you know, but that's just me. So
I can't really do garlic at night as much.
Because
garlic just pours right through me. I'm saying that garlic just comes right out of my pores.
I hear you, but won't that happen in the morning too? I mean, you know, you'd be garlicky all day.
Well, I don't know. I just think that some of the other things that I may take may, you know, not allow the garlic to, like, overpower it. But at night, forget it.
Well, you know, there you go.
I'm laying next to the missus, and there's the garlic.
I didn't want to go there. I was going to say nothing, you know me. But he said, I don't have that problem. My wife don't care. She, you know, she don't care. I snore. She don't care. She don't care nothing. That's why I love her.
That's now, my wife is good too, but the thing is that her nose is so sensitive.
There you go. Well, there's the problem.
Like you said, I could have did garlic like early in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
You know, with the breakfast and stuff like that.
Mm.
And it'll be late in the evening. It's like, you had garlic today, didn't you?
Oh no, that's that sensitive nose, man. Too bad. Tough luck.
Sorry
about that. But
I have to say, during the time of COVID, because garlic is good for you, hey, garlic is in me.
Yeah. Well, I'm not doing garlic now for some reason. I think I move around too much. I mean, I was doing garlic down in Virginia, but not a lot, just to cook. But let me tell you my garlic story. This is great. You're going to love this.
Okay.
Now, you remember, Noel, this is like 1980. Basically, the New Year's Eve of 1990, I was basically in the air. There's a picture of me with the time stamp on there. I was like New Year's Eve. I was in the air going from New York to Guatemala.
Right.
Okay. This is my defining trip. This is when I was gone for like 4 months. This is quite by accident. They had just named me as what? Production engineer for WBAI. Okay.
Okay.
And, you know, I said, okay, I'm going away. I'll be back in 2 months, you know? Well, I didn't get back to like 4 months later. You know, I didn't care. You know, the Dred Scott Keys, you know, I got him a little extra money or something like that for not showing up. But here's the funny thing. I even sent a postcard. I was down in Guatemala and Belize. And I sent a postcard, and you know, of course, I got back before the postcard. Remember, this is 1990. And I purposely did this trip, and I purposely said I wasn't going to do any, remember, this is right before cell phones was really, actually, before cell phones was big, was at all, I guess. There was no cell phones. So I purposely didn't listen to anything. You know, I didn't listen to no shortwave, I was in Guatemala and Belize, Livingston, Guatemala. Belize is English, but Livingston, Guatemala. And so it's Spanish. So I didn't pay attention to anything. But the three pieces of news that got through was that the Sandinistas lost the election, right?
Right.
That Mandela was free from jail, right? And that Mike Tyson lost to Buster Douglas. Those are the three pieces of information that got through.
Yeah.
But just natural people, you know what I'm saying? I'll drop this.
Yeah.
You know. So it was kind of interesting. But in that trip, when I first went, because it was my first time, but I had been out the country a few months before I went to Panama. Right before Noriega got deposed. That's an interesting story too. But anyway, and before then, that was 1989, late 89, in 88, I had gone in for my birthday in July of 88. I had gone to Canada. I took a train trip to Canada. I just jumped on the train. It was my birthday. I just jumped on the train, which I usually do anyway. I knew where I was going. I just jumped. Oh, go to Canada. So basically, I was officially, I guess, my third time out of the country. I mean, you know, like that. Because I never left the country. When I was in the service, I never left the country. I had an opportunity to put it right there. I think back then, I actually also knew that if I left, that I would be traveling forever. Like basically when I was in the Air Force in the early 70s, that I would just keep on traveling, which actually happened in the late 80s, exactly what happened. I started traveling. That was it. I was gone all the time. So anyway, when I first came, because people just scared about it, they say, no, don't drink the water, you know, watch the ice and all the rest of that stuff. You got to take garlic. So I was popping garlic like candy. I mean, garlic cloves, I was just eating. I was eating garlic like a maniac, you know what I mean? I remember one time, what happened? There was some drink I hadn't had ice in. I forgot I was drinking it. And I'm going like, oh, it's weird. And then when I went over to Livingston, Guatemala, you know, basically in northern Guatemala, you have Puerto Barrios and Livingston are basically black people. They look like us, you know, like that.
Right.
But there's this place in Livingston, Guatemala.
Is that the Garifunas?
Yeah, the Garifunas. Just exactly.
Yeah, I remember you always said that. If you were going to claim any people, you would claim the Garifuna people.
Exactly. And I actually believe that is my lineage on my father's side. And that's an interesting story. But I'll tell you a story just before I get to it. Let me just finish this. At one time, even there's this little river that in Livingston, Guatemala, this tiny river, like Livingston is like a peninsula, if you want to put it that way. And at some point, there's you have the peninsula, the tip of the peninsula goes, you take a launch that gets over to Puerto Barrios, which is the main part of, gets to Guatemala. There's like a little river, and then you go over this river. It's a tiny river. You can walk over it, whatever have you. But then on that other side, there's no development. You know, there's no lights or nothing like that. In fact, that's where you keep on going. That's where they have what's called the Seven Altar Waterfalls. You know, and these waterfalls, there's basically seven levels that go down. So anyway, that little river, for some reason, I got there and I just drank out the river. I was going like, this is ridiculous. So I just drank water out the river. I think I was thirsty or something like that. And I was saying, yeah, I'm drinking snail piss and whatever. frog dung or whatever was in that water. But I didn't get sick. I don't get sick when I travel. But so that's it. So I was just that trip that was going for 4 months. I was popping garlic like crazy, man. It was unbelievable. But the reason why I'm doing this licorice and stuff like that, because it's good for the lungs, you know?
It's
really good for the lungs. And as you know, I'm a vet, but I'm in the VA system. for all those stupid people that don't want Medicare for All. I don't know what's wrong with them, but you know, the VA sent me automatically. They just sent me B12. They got it. I said, "What the hell? What's this for?" And then I didn't realize, but you know, it's because it's COVID. So it's because the lungs and stuff like that. So I just started, you know, that. But it's the licorice that goes down and cleans out that lungs that you have. And I notice now when I walk in the morning, anytime, if I do have these tiny, tiny, I can feel like it's really cleaning out my lungs. Not that my lungs are dirty, but it's really cleaning it out, you know. So that's why I'm doing the licorice. I got this tea right now brewing, you know. I gotta
get some of that.
Oh yeah, it's definitely I think the licorice root. I think it's licorice root. There's all kinds, but this is licorice tea. But the trick with all this stuff, people don't realize the trick with all this stuff, especially these kind of beverages, you got to cut down on your sugar, man. I used to put like maple syrup and stuff. These last few months, I have really had sweets. I just, for my birthday, had a cake that made me a red, black, and green cake, you know, with my name, you know, happy birthday, Anthony, red, black, and green icing, you know. It was really nice. I put it up someplace on my Instagram or someplace. I think I even put it up on someplace. But it's really nice cake, and it's carrot cake inside. So I was munching on that. Yeah, I mean, it was great. It was great, you know, and the red said on the red stripe it had happy it was red, black, and green. Where's the black? No, but I was in black somehow. Red, black, and I don't know how. All I know, my name, well, the black had Anthony on it somehow. I don't know. Anyway, so but because I'm not doing any sugar and stuff like that, my body, and I always cut down on the salt anyway, so my body's just these other flavors and stuff like it really, really, really comes through. So I advise everybody in this time of COVID, just change your habits, you know?
Man, I've been working on it, but it's kind of hard. Sometimes you just get those moments where you're just bored.
You're bored.
And, you know, you drink some water, you're like, okay, I had some water. You drink some more water, you're like, And then that little sugar monster sometimes, like, just a little taste, just a little bit.
No, man. Oh, you know what?
It's a battle. It's a battle.
No, I'm sorry. That's true. I don't do any refined sugar, any of that stuff. Like, but what I have been doing, I haven't cut back on that, on this. See, I love dark chocolate. Me and dark chocolate, we like two peas in a pod, you know, we like.
Yeah. Like that cacao.
Like the woo?
The cacao.
A cow.
Cacao.
Yeah. But I like, for instance, I have this trail mix. It's not really a trail mix because all it is raw cashews. And then I have dark chocolate covered blueberries. And dark chocolate covered pistachio nut, a shell pistachio nuts, and so that's my little trail mix. Not really a lot of the chocolate, whatever have you, but I might munch. I'm not that bad on that. I might munch. Like when I'm through with you here tonight, I might take a couple of mouthfuls. You know what I mean? And just chew on that. But that's it. That's my chocolate craving, and that's it. You know.
Yeah.
And when I remember when I was in Virginia, I purposely got I like Milky Way Midnight, you know, the dark one, you know.
So I
did that. I did one bar. That it's strange. I can do like one something and then be satisfied. That's it. You know what I mean? I won't have to deal with it ever, like for months, whatever, you know.
Yeah.
So that's my story. So anyway, so that's the thing. People got to just try, please. Oh, man. Oh, I'm not why I'm concerned about people. Hey, you know, after you're 9 years old, you can't tell anybody what to do. All you got to do is just be the example. That's what I learned. My eldership taught me this. Just be the example. People want to take your example or they don't. It's not your, you're not supposed to be beating stuff over. You're not supposed to make people do stuff. You know what I mean? You just can't do it.
No. But they ain't going to do it anyway.
That's true. Oh, that's a whole other. My sister too. I'm not gonna. You know, I talk a lot, so you better just start talking. But my sister, for years, I've been trying to make her eat healthy. You know what I mean? Literally, for every time I come in, try to make her. Well, this last time I came in, I get, you know, the diabetes, the pre-diabetes test, the ALC or whatever that the test is. Hers, there's a certain normal range. And her came, she was like over the range, you know, just going over. And she panicked because, you know, my grandmother had diabetes, had to take insulin every day and with the needle and stuff like that. So we have, I guess we have diabetes in our family. My ALC, I think it was a little bit elevated, but I know that's just from, I can control that, but just not eating the chocolate, you know? But anyway, so she got woof. And, you know, my family is like, when they get crazed with something, they just go all the way in. It doesn't matter what age you are. They just go, you know? And so my sister, she started, you know, really, you know, I've been talking about eating and eating, but, you know, it has to come from somebody else. And she went online and some person, they said, look, forget about all these diets and everything. All you got to do is watch your carbs. Watch your carbs. No more than 45 carbs a day. Read your packages. And I always tell her to read the package. And so, and of course, you have to exercise a little. So she's been like walking 3 miles a day. And she just
That's
washed.
Great.
Yeah. And then she washed her carbs. She doesn't snack. The other thing is snacking.
Yeah.
And, you know, people snack on what they junk. So those carbs are way up. And plus, you know, the pasta and all the rest of that stuff. She doesn't do any. Anyway,
Yeah,
so what she did was basically she lost, I think she said she was something like 190, and now she's like at 170. She's probably lower than that now. But remember, she has big bones too. So it doesn't really, you know, it's kind of strange because I'm the only one in the family that have, like, I got the piano fingers, you know what I mean? Everybody else is like, you know, I don't know. Anyway, I was so happy, man. And then that's how we going out shopping, you know. She's listening to me finally, you know, just to get, it was great. I had a really great time with my sister. And I go back and see her. And when I get back and we'll spend Thanksgiving together. So in November, I'll see her. So she should be at the weight that she wants to be. I think she wants to be about like 150 or something like that. But, you know, she's got the curves and everything like that. I mean, look, when my sister was young, oh, man, she was so fine. But she, you know, the Jordache jeans. She could have been a Jordache jean model. That kind of thing.
It's
really, really beautiful. I mean, she had the legs and the like that. A black woman. You know, you know what I'm talking about. You know, Lordy B. You know, so I'm just lucky that I didn't have to protect her because, you know, she grew up in the Patterson Project. She can go run out with hoodlums and stuff like that. She protect herself, you know. I didn't have to do that. Plus, everybody knew because, you know, she had three older brothers, you know. And Lawrence, my younger brother, who died, and he was a criminal anyway, so nobody would bother my family. Nobody would bother her. Everybody knew there was going to be a problem. There was going to be problems.
You never talk about him.
Who, Lawrence?
Yeah.
That's because Now, Lawrence, man, you know, he's a career criminal. The thing is, you know, we all were in some
career criminal.
No, really, no, I'm serious, you know. But we all we all have our specialties. Let's put it that way. But Lawrence, the thing is, it was Gregory and Anthony, right? And Rachel and Regina, the twins, and then Vincent, that's a whole other story. Can't talk about him either. He's, depending who you believe, he either was sold by his daddy or was, I don't know, he just disappeared. You know, we have his birth certificate, but that's about all. But I think his father was Italian or something like that. I don't know, Mexican, Italian, something like that. But Lawrence then, but when the family came together, Lawrence was the last one to come. But he, because he was in another foster kind of situation, and me and my brother was in one foster situation. Rachel and Gina was in another situation, and then Lawrence was in another foster home. So he came to us late. So when I say late, maybe about a year later, then we all came. We're all very young, 5, 6, 7 years old. Yeah, 5, 6, 7 years old, like that. And so anyway, when he came, he sort of came late, and he would just. I mean, he was so institutionalized, I think, that he just didn't fit in, you know? So he would run away from all the time. And I would tell her, I said, Lawrence, look, man, because my grandmother was a worrier. I said, look, just please, just call grandma. This is when you just dial up. It says, just call grandma so she can go to bed because she's a worrier, blah, 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 you know? But, you know, it wasn't to be. But I'm going to tell you the kind of criminal my brother was. Lawrence was. First of all, to me, he was the smartest out of all of us as far as intellect goes, the smartest, right? I think he was mathematics and all that. So he was very, 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 extremely smart. And as you know, my family's actually pretty smart, to tell you the truth.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, you're pretty smart for sure.
So what happened was this boy, it was like, he's like Omar, but not the homosexuality. Like he would stick up criminals. He would stick up drug dealers and stuff like that. In fact, he's so crazy. Well, you know, in the early, this is the early 80s. Yeah, in the early 80s, we hung out for a second in the early 80s when we were older. In the early 80s, what happened? He was somehow, let's put it this way. Let me give you one scenario. One time, all three of the brothers my older brother, Gregory, me, and Lawrence Ward, we all went out together. It was like 1981 or something like that. We all went out together, and Gregory took us out. He took us to Brooklyn. It was like a sex club. When I say sex club, it was one of those things. This was like early things. This is not pole dancing like that, where they had sex acts right there, you know, and, you know, people come in, they have sex acts right there on the stage, and that kind of thing. And I think Lawrence had just got out of jail, one of his times in jail. So he was going to the club, so Gregory went in first, and then me and Lawrence went in together. He had to pat you down, whatever have you. And the guy said something, and Lawrence was a little taller than us, too. He's like 6 feet, you know? So he put his hand up, no, I'm a punk. And I go, oh, Lord, oh, because the way he said it, you know, this boy was, no, he just, no. Oh, I hope nothing happens, please. So anyway, but Lawrence, one time he, in like the early 80s, and this one, they started letting women on the police force. Now, to show you, I think this is just a thing with my family. We were just all crazy, right? He was going with this police woman one time. He actually took that. They were sleep. I went, maybe she went to sleep, whatever it is. He took her gun and committed a robbery with her gun. This, you know, first, Lord. I'm telling you, man, you know, I know a lot of crazy people. I mean, because, you know, you grew up in the project, you know, whatever, you know, a lot of people, you know. But I'm telling you, some of the stuff I look at, my brother, my older brother, he could drive anything. One time I was with him, we was driving mid-Manhattan. I don't know what this dude did. This boy went up on a sidewalk and drove on a sidewalk to get past this thing. I'm so, this is mid-Manhattan. It's like the 40s. And I don't know what, you know. I'm not going to tell you about my craziness because I think I'm sane. So anyway, that's it like that. Let me sip.
That's how our peoples are, though. We're very original. You know, we're very unorthodox.
Man, you know, if I will tell you right now, I've been a lot of places on the planet, and I just would never want to be anything but, you know, Black American ADOS. There's nothing better. There's just nothing better. I can't explain. There's just some sort of smoothness, some sort of the brain that thinks, I don't know. I have no idea. Maybe this is what happens when you grow up in a war zone that you know, you're not looking for bombs up in the air. You just look, everything is dangerous. You know, everything is dangerous, but you just don't have the bombs falling on you. So what's this? So you're stuck someplace. I just wanted to ask you. So what are you doing? Like I said, I have a whole regimen of tablets. Maybe I'll bring them out sometimes that I do throughout the day. And I'm drinking my tea. I drink water a lot. In fact, for some reason, I don't know why, in New York, I started to get this acid reflux. I never had it in my life. And so I just started to think, I said, well, maybe I'm not drinking enough water. Maybe I had drunk a little wine, whatever, but I haven't, you know, I don't drink heavy. So I don't know what it was. But anyway, then I just thought, if it's acid reflux, it means there's acid coming up from your stomach. Just drink more water. So I just drank. I increased the water even more, and lo and behold, I'm here, and I'm no acid reflux. I'm cool. You know, hey, you know.
Yeah, I think a lot of times the acid reflux, some of it comes from stress, from the stress of the situation. And believe you me, I am an authority on acid reflux.
Really? Ooh, tell me about it.
Okay. I didn't know that I was suffering from it for a few years.
But don't you have asthma? Don't you have asthma, something like that?
Yeah, I do. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Since I was 6 months old.
Yeah, because I remember when I first, was I the person who told you about oregano oil?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so I told you about oregano oil, and I don't know if that worked for you a little bit, but go ahead. Acid reflux and asthma.
It did, but, you know, once again, what happened with the reflux, right? I think the reflux was due to, like, a number of situations. Like, a lot of people just go, oh, well, it's what you eat. Mm. But it's more than just what you eat. It's your environment, and you're not working the subway.
Oh, yeah.
It was sometimes it's the times you eat. You talk about that too. Mm. And when I worked, we were only allowed like a half hour for lunch.
So you
that's to get it?
Yeah, you got to eat fast. Yeah.
Get back to work. Yeah.
Mm.
So imagine doing that for like 20 something years.
Mm.
Then you had the situation of you're around people all the time. Your co-workers, the public and stuff. So, you know, I would chew gum, mint flavored gum, or chew on mints.
Mm.
Mints is another thing that affects, you'll develop the reflux from that.
Mm.
It's like too much of that, you know, in the system. Then you had, what else? When you get the reflux, right, you feel the burning in your throat. So I eventually got esophagitis.
That doesn't sound good.
Nah, it wasn't, bro. It wasn't. So the way I found out about it was I had a colonoscopy. My first colonoscopy, I was like 49, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I had my first colonoscopy, and then the gastroenterologist, this guy was a cool dude. He was a video game guy, right?
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. And his video game handle, because he's played like the first person shooters and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
He was called the Gastro Master.
Oh Lord! talk about triple entendre. Gee.
Exactly, Gastro Master, right? So this guy, he's like, have you ever had an endoscopy? Because you said you suffer from acid reflux. I said, no. So he said, well, I'm going to give you one of those. We'll do a combination. So literally in one setting, I had the tube going one way. And then after that, the tube going the other way.
Hopefully it wasn't the same tube, man.
No, it wasn't. We had that discussion before. I'm like, how's this going to work? So he said that my esophagus was so chewed up.
What?
That, yeah, he said it was chewed up. And I'm like, yeah, but I don't really, I've had acid reflux, but not that bad. He goes, well, when you're sleeping, if you're knocked out of sleep and stuff like that, and that stomach acid starts crawling up your esophagus, depending on how you sleep and everything. Because, when you have acid reflux, they want you to sit. They almost want you sitting up while you're sleeping.
They want you doing what while you're sleeping?
Kind of sitting up.
You have to sit up, okay.
You got to sit up.
Oh, okay.
You got to go to sleep with like a wedge or something to keep your head way above your stomach.
Okay.
Otherwise, and I'm saying not just your stomach. I'm saying like you can't sleep like normal people sleep.
Mm.
You got to sleep. With the head like really inclined.
Mm-hmm.
So he said, you're probably sleeping, snoring, whatever. And that ass will just blah, blah, blah. You may have been so tired, you didn't even wake up. Like on occasions I did, but there were occasions that, you just wake up with a sour taste in your mouth.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Wow.
So he said, wow, this is chewed up, man. He said, I thought you had, I was thinking, we're going to do a biopsy. You might have cancer, like throat cancer.
What?
And I'm like, throat cancer? Isn't that for people who smoke? He's like, no. He said, look, it's bad. So the biopsy was benign. So everything was good. So he gave me some medication to like coat the throat.
Mm-hmm.
But when I used to take it, I was like, oh, man, this is like nasty. It, It's like, remember back in the day you had penicillin, it was like pink, like a pink liquid.
Yeah.
But this is like five times thicker and five times nastier. And I was like, I can't tell. I had to tell him, Doc, there got to be something else. So he said, well, you know, and remember you talked about the Indians before, right? Mm. Say, well, the Indians use Manuka honey.
Ah.
Now, you're familiar with Manuka honey, right?
No, I'm not really. But I know I've heard of it very in my back of my brain, but I don't know, you know.
Well, it's like a real thick honey. A lot of places where it grows, like where they make it, is in New Zealand. I think also in India.
Of course.
And they have different grades of it. And it's almost like a caramel sort of taffy like.
Oh, okay.
But it's very thick.
Yeah, I know it.
It coats the throat and it heals it.
I ran across it in India. Yes, I didn't have to use. I didn't use it, but I ran. Okay, I know what you're saying. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. So you said what you do is you take some bread and you dip it in that honey and roll it into little balls and you just eat that and swallow it and stuff. So over time, and then you know, he told me what to avoid, which was, you know, obviously mint. You know, your favorite thing, dark chocolate, avoid that. Coffee, green tea for a while. There was like a lot of things that I was doing that I was like, nope, you can't do that. You can't do that. I was even at the time was juicing with like a lot of green juices and like the green granny apple and pineapple. He's like, no. A lot of citrus, no. So oranges, no more. Mm. Grapefruit, lemons. I was doing like lemon cleanses, like can't do that. Apple cider vinegar, he's like, nope, too acidic. Even though it's like not acidic in the system, but going down the throat is acidic.
So, so you can take a tablet, right?
Yeah, as long as like the tablets and things like that that you can take for that, you can do that. But don't do it like how you had said earlier in the day, like do stuff earlier in the day and don't do it in the evening. Certain things you do in the evening, certain things you do early in the day. Well, those are the type of things you had to do early in the day to give the body a chance to really go through the digestive process. Mm-hmm. But if you did it like, you know, 2 or 3 hours before you went to bed, then you're going to have a problem.
Mm-hmm.
I used to have to take like some medications, but the doctor said that, you know, we're going to obviously give you another endoscopy to check out your throat. And if it's improved, then you can sort of slow down with that. So I was like, cool. So I did it. Everything was good for a couple of years. And then I started having like a lot of like joint pain and stuff like that. And even though I was doing turmeric for that, The way I was working was like,
The secret with turmeric, I don't know if you know this, is you really have
the black pepper.
Yeah, you have to take the black pepper. Yeah, okay.
Oh, definitely. The one that I was taking was called Turmeric Supreme. And Turmeric Supreme was turmeric. It was like a 2-to-1 with the turmeric and the black pepper. And you know, they clearly told you that, like, yeah, it's the black pepper that activates it, that gets it going.
Yeah.
And it did help.
Yeah.
But in the process of still, you know, being in pain and working every day, I had to take at times Aleve. So, you know, those Naces, Aleve, Advil, things like that.
Yeah.
So I was taking Aleve and the pain was going away. I was able to like, hey, I could go up and down the stairs, no problem. I could move, blah, 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 no problem. But what that was doing was going and attacking the throat again.
Okay.
Yeah. So the way I found out was one day I went to do my usual constitutional. And all of a sudden I started bleeding out of my nose.
What?
Yeah. And then bleeding out of my mouth.
That doesn't sound right. I mean, good.
Yeah. And bleeding out of the other end of my body, too.
Gee.
In total, that whole incident took maybe less than 5 minutes. In 5 minutes, I lost like 3.5 liters of blood.
No, 3.5 liters of blood?
Yeah.
Did you say liters?
Yeah.
Well, how could you walk?
Well.
You should have been fainted.
Oh, I was fainted. Because what happened was, I was in the bathroom, and it was like a scene out of that show, Dexter.
Mm.
Blood was everywhere.
Oh, man, oh, God.
I called my wife, and instead of us, you know, calling an ambulance, you know, I got dressed, we got in the car right away, we went straight to the ER.
Mm.
And then when we were at the ER, they were like, okay, you know, since nobody was there, thank God. And they took me right away. So, you know, they said that I had an ulcer in my esophagus that burst. And that's what caused it. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Ooh, I was trying to figure that out. Okay. All right.
Yeah. So that's what it was. So obviously the blood got loose and it was looking for a place to go. So it went to every orifice that it could find.
Wow.
Yeah.
Dang. Well, oof. Man, you know, I used to be a lab technician. When I got out of the service, one of my jobs, I was working at the principal. It was Princeton Hospital when I started, but then it became Princeton Medical Center. Whenever they have a medical center in front of that means when you used to have a hospital and they change over to a medical center, yeah. just means it has more administrators than it has doctors. That's all that means. Okay.
Yeah.
So anyway, so I worked. I worked usually blood banking in the chemistry department, also blood banking department. But I was such a good phlebotomist, you know, drawing the blood. I was just amazing. In fact, what's acknowledged as the perfect play that I wrote in graduate school is called A Pig's Death. And it's about how this lab technician basically bled this guy out, you know, because he was a racist, you know, whatever. This white guy, bled him out. It's quite a good play. And not because I wrote it. Not because it was just a really good play. So anyway, I'm telling you, man, if I take a pint of blood out of you. That's why when you go in blood, they try to give you some sugar or some, you know, apple juice or something like that, because just a pint will get you dizzy. So if you had 3 liters, lordy be, what's 3 liters?
And the funny thing was, like years before, you know, when the churches have their blood bank drives, and I was actually part of like a blood bank ministry. So I would give the pint of blood.
Mm.
And then they had that, and you may know about this machine called the Alifax machine, where it takes out a certain part of the blood and then puts back the rest of it. So it's almost like you're giving like a 2 liters, so to speak.
Mm.
But I used to do that because I was O negative. So since I was O negative, it was like, oh yeah, man, we need that blood. So
no, that was after my time, but I know what you're talking about. It's almost like a dialysis machine.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Oof. Man, lordy B, yuck. I actually can't take these stories. It's so weird because when I was a lab technician, I did everything. I did autopsies. I'm the kind of person that could actually eat over a dead body in the autopsy room. You know, in a morgue. You know, it didn't matter to me. You know, remember you saw Quincy and he wanted to get on the case and he made all the students just faint. You know, like that. I would be the students going like, oh, well, where are you going? Hey, no. I'm still here. I would be like, it's so weird. But for now, I can't. I don't like needles. That's probably why. I don't like anything gruesome. You know, don't get me wrong. I can watch these blood films and stuff like that. But even that, I don't like the Saw films. All those kind of films, I don't deal with none of that stuff anymore. I don't know what happened to my brain, but I know what happened when I went to Senegal and I almost got yanked by my ancestors. That's another story. But anyway, but I changed since then. But, you know, when I hear these stories, I say, I mean, thank goodness that you came through all that, man. Let me put it this way. Are you stronger for it? That's the question.
Oh, absolutely. Stronger and wiser. Because, you know, when it happened, this happened the day before my birthday.
Oh, now you know what I'm going to say about that, but go ahead.
Yeah, the 52 days. But I'm saying this was like literally like October 12th.
Oof.
That's right. I was in the hospital.
Yeah, you're a four.
Operated one, yeah. Well, it wasn't really an operation. They call it a procedure, you know. I don't know what you want to call it, but that's what it was.
Oh, an operation means there's a bunch of people. A procedure means there's less people. That's all.
Oh, okay.
Operation means there's a lot of people attending to you. A procedure, you know, you may have an anesthesiologist, a nurse, and a doctor, you know, maybe.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes.
That's what I had. I think that's what I had.
Yeah, sometimes with a procedure, you might even just have a doctor, you know, with the nurse that's got to be around or somebody close at hand. But operation, that's when you go in the theater and they're rolling you in and it's a thing, you know. Wow.
Yeah.
But here's what I want to get to. I got to get off that, man. So now you retired from the Transit Authority, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm so happy.
Yeah. See now, one of those that led to me saying, you know what? I'm just gonna put in my time till I get the age, and I'm out of here. I can't do this no more.
Because you had one of the worst jobs too, the maintenance thing, right?
Yeah. Oh, you know the essential workers that they talk about today.
Mm.
Yeah, we were considered almost like invisible, non-essential, much maligned workers prior to COVID. Now we're essential workers. We're the most essential. And I was like, while I was working there, I was we're the most essential all the time, because what Trump calls now the invisible enemy, I was saying the invisible enemy ever since I was working there. I said everybody else, whatever you deal with your job and your title, and many of those titles, they definitely believed in their heart, not just because their salary was higher, but they were more important than the cleaners. And with me, I was like, look, we're fighting things that we can't even see.
Mm-hmm.
And now with COVID, now everybody understands that. I knew about PPE since I first came in there. And we had PPE training every year. So I'm like, people are like, what's PPE? It's like, yeah, now you know what PPE is. Yeah, it was definitely rough. It was rough.
I remember, you know, when 9/11 happened, I don't want to say it bothered me, but look, I thought it was a bit. When they started praising, I understand why they did the firefighters. I don't even know why the police was ever, but the firefighters and police could have dragging people out the building. But what people didn't understand is that remember that's Port Authority, and the cleaners, the sanitation department, they were the real heroes when they had to go in and pull that stuff out. I'm gonna say real heroes, because you know, saving people's lives and stuff like that, that's heroic.
Yeah.
Whatever. But those are heroes that you see. You know what I mean? But the real first response with that, there was the people down there. I don't know what they called us, but basically the sanitation people for the Port Authority, whatever it is, they're the ones that was pulling all kinds of stuff out. Even afterwards, they're the ones that affected much more than the fire people and the whatever have you, because they're down there with the raw stuff, man. And they didn't get any props.
We were down there too.
That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. Yeah, you too. But I'm just saying the Port Authority was one in charge. They would whatever it is. But yeah, because you're down in the subway system there too. Yeah, I got you, man.
Yeah, because when remember, like the World Trade, it's like it's Port Authority, but it's connected to the E and the A train.
Yep.
That was us. And as a matter of fact, like the day it happened, I was working in Queens. But after you know, at the end of my work shift, I was, you know, blessed enough that at the end of my shift, I was at my home station. So I just went home from there, and immediately I said, look, I know they're going to call us tomorrow and they're going to have us go down there and stuff. I said, I got to go sick. Because I said, I'm too sick to deal with this mentally and everything. And I said, I got asthma. I can't go down there. I can't be in that environment. So I took a couple of days off. But when I came back to work, the first place they put me was one of the closest places to 9/11, which was West 4th Street. And while I was working West 4th Street, they called me to come to the booth and wait for a supervisor. And when the supervisors and the groups came, they came with other cleaners and other supervisors and stuff, and they were going to go down there. They were going to take a train down there and go count the money in the booths and take all the money out.
Hmm.
But they grabbed me to do that as well. So I was down there that day, that Friday. So it was like, it happened, I think 9/11 happened on Tuesday.
Yeah, coming on
that
Tuesday.
Friday, I was there. I was there that day.
Wow. Oh, man. But you know, oh, do you know my 9/11 story? Oh, my goodness. You know, I was working Democracy Now! When 9/11 hit.
Yeah.
But we weren't at 120 Wall Street. We were at the Fire Garrett down there at Downtown Television, you know, John Albert and Keiko's place. You know, we was in the Garrett up there in the fire station up there. It was converted fire station that he turned it into basically a training place for video thing, for community thing. And so that's where they set us up there in that garage. So remember, it was still, it wasn't a TV program yet. It wasn't, you know, well, whatever it was. And so I'm on, and I'm going to tell you right now, I didn't hear the first, I don't know about the first plane, but the second plane, because we came on the air at 9 o'clock. And when we just came on, yeah, like a few minutes after, you know how if you're in New York, you're used to hearing on the ground, you know, those big metal plates, and if a truck goes over, you hear it, the rumbling, you can feel it.
Yeah.
Well, it was like that. You know how your brain picks up stuff. But, you know, you're working. And I swear that second plane, I hear like a rumbling. It was like in the sky, the same thing that we hear on the ground with that kind of rumbling. I heard in the sky. So I heard that. You know, was I heard the, because we're in Lafayette Street, right below Canal Street. You know, is where we were broadcasting from. So when that plane hit, when that plane came, I sort of heard that. A few minutes later, Keiko, John Albert's wife, she comes up. She's like Asian, she came up very, you know, very quiet because we were in the middle of broadcast, and she's sort of trying to get our attention because it was just me and Amy. It was me, Amy. I don't think Brad was there yet. I don't think Miranda was there yet. I forgot. It was somebody else. Anyway, me, Amy, and a producer. It wasn't a lot of us, just, you know, because program, whatever. And so she came and said, I think you should turn on the TV, because in the next room there was a TV. She turned on the TV and said, whoa. So I immediately put a bud in my ear, and I think I always had a little radio or something like that. And I immediately, of course, I went to 1010 Winds, you know what I mean? Because that's the New York, if you want news, that's the New York station, the AM station. So so I was getting up from there. And so we just immediately started broadcasting like that. So if you hear those early tapes, when that hit, you actually hear my voice saying, hey, this world has changed forever. You hear me trying to report, whatever, because I'm not reporting. I'm an engineer, whatever. I don't really do the news kind of thing. So, I'm basically, it's me and Amy talking back and forth, you know, as the other producers running around getting stuff, blah, blah, blah. But I say that only because for a month, I didn't. Anyway, so then they block. I don't get into all that stuff, but I was still doing No More Radio, right? And I was still at the station, let's put it that way, which is at 120 Wall Street. So I could walk from the Garrett, because the cutoff mark was like basically Canal Street. They had like canals. Was it Canal Street, Houston Street, and 14th Street? You know what I mean? They were all, because they were all blocked off. So if you wasn't living in those areas, unless you knew the subway system, you couldn't go. You can go. So I knew the subway system, so I can get down right before Canal Street, and then I can get over there and scoot over to the thing. And only one time I was stopped, waylaid. That was what, strangely enough, it was a Latino cop, you know what I mean? Trying to follow the orders, you know what I mean? I said, look, I'm working right over there. You can see. I'm working right there. Let me go. Nah, he's going. I said, this guy, man. I had to wait and wait and wait. Because I used to come and get them food, because I would leave at night. They would stay there. They would occupy that. And, you know, they would be there all the time. And I would come and I'd bring them food and stuff like that. But anyway, I say that all is to say, but when I was walking, and I would walk at night, I would go to 120 Wall Street, right? And I'm telling you, you could see, because they had these lights up, and it was amazing. It was really like an apocalypse. It was like those scenes that you see, but to feel the thing, to see the air with all the particles in the air, the lights, it looked really like a science fiction, apocalyptic, whatever. It was like amazing. I go like, whoa, you know. I mean, I'll forever see that.
That's exactly what I saw the day that I was there, because we were underground. So we were in that passageway of the E connecting to the World Trade itself.
Yeah, I know that one. Mm-hmm.
So now that whole area was like decimated. It was almost like in Beneath the Planet of the Apes, right? Subway scene in there like that.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
But then I said, I got to go upstairs. So I went and snuck upstairs, right? And it was raining that day. Right. So you had like the rain. So you had like the fog.
Yeah.
Some rain.
Yep.
You could smell the metal and stuff like that. I saw like the twisted metal.
Yep.
And I never forget, like I was wearing the, yes, PPE, right? Which I bought myself. Because I had a feeling that they're going to, if I go in that area, they're going to take me over there. So I bought my own PPE that I've already had. So I had my goggles. I had the suit. A suit that would fit me, right? I had the gloves. I had everything. The mask, all of that. And literally had to put it on while we were on the subway with people there. So it was a train. I think the train was like a number one train.
Yeah.
So we got on the, no, not a one, I'm sorry. It was an A train. Okay. It was at West 4th Street. So we got on the A. Right, A's going to the Rockaway. So we get on that West 4. I pull out everything out of my backpack with the supervisor. He's like, you got equipment? I have some for you. I said, no, I have my own. I pulled mine out. He said, oh, so you were prepared. I'm like, yeah, I'm not trying to, you know, I'm not trying to have nothing happen to me. Right? So I'm putting on everything. Customers are looking at me and stuff. The train pulls into that area. They open up one door and we walk out in full gear and it closes. So then, you know, we did some of our work of, you know, allegedly cleaning while they were counting the money and stuff like that. So at some point I snuck upstairs. So when I saw all the stuff that was upstairs, I remember I saw like cases of water. So I was like, oh, it's not that water over here. So I went to look at the water. And as soon as something said to me, look straight ahead. I looked straight ahead. There was a National Guard with their rain gear on, with the long rifle and stuff, looking right at me. But he didn't say anything because I was in PPE. So he would have said, oh, you want some water or something? I was like, no. But then I looked over to the left and I saw two people walking towards me, like walking, like they were going to walk past me. And one of them was like Curtis Sliwa and another dude holding them up. And he was crying. It was crazy.
Oh, Curtis Sliwa was trying to be a hero and go in there and rescue some people. What happened?
I don't know what he was trying to do, but I guess maybe he had to go down there to see it for himself. Because, you know, obviously this is like, you know, 3 days later, but I mean, it really looked bad, though. It looked bad. And it definitely looked like a movie set out of something, like you said, out of a sci-fi movie, or maybe even like Carnage from some post-apocalyptic movie or a superhero movie. Where there's carnage and stuff, it just looked like that.
There's two things I always remember. I always remember that look, that wreckage, right? And the other thing I always remember is this: there was no sound in the sky. That was eerie. Not to, in New York, not to hear a plane. That was very strange. Not even I guess we had emergency vehicles, but there was like no sound.
Yeah.
Wow. When I say, of course, it was sound, but it's not. You know what I'm talking about? Whoa.
Yeah.
I'm like, man, that was something. That was something. Those were the days. But look, man, let's stop this now because, you know, it's getting long, whatever have you. And maybe we'll talk again. You know, Thursday's a good day. We last time we talked was a Tuesday.
Yeah.
I want to do this twice a week. I don't know if we want to do it. I don't want to mess up your weekends. But then again, you can't go no place anyway. Well, you ain't going.
Let's push for next Thursday.
I was thinking of twice a week, Tuesdays and Thursdays. But let's do Thursday is fine. This Thursday is fine. Let's do Thursday is fine. Yeah. Okay, we put it on that schedule. Okay, man. Look, anything else, man? Anything else to have any recollections about the days of COVID or whatever it is? Unbelievable. You know?
Yeah, COVID, I mean, to me, like, this is like, it kind of reminds you of 9/11 in a way because it's like just ongoing.
Truly.
Just ongoing. You have to wonder to yourself, are we ever going to get past this?
That's it. You don't know when it's going to end. You know if it's going to end or when it's going to end. There's too many questions. And questions leads to despair. It's interesting you had talked about, you know, stress, the kind of stress you had with your job. But this is a kind of stress, too. The whole planet is stressing right now. So it's really interesting. I'm lucky that I'm where I am right now because, like, there's a lot of trees. There's a lot of the dog that got here. This guy's a maniac. It was a girl dog. I say guys anyway. This is a squirrel hunter.
Wow.
In fact, we had to go out and buy her a different. Can't do the leash. Got to actually do a harness because you know how if you do the leash, then that actually affects the dog's throat. If it keeps on pulling on that leash, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So just to protect the dog, you know, we had to get her a harness. So when I walk her in the morning, because I walk her for like an hour and a half or something like that, but she's been straight.
Yeah, I've seen it in the video.
Oh, did
making a guest appearance? Yeah.
Oh, well, that was just she was just sitting next to me. Yeah.
That's
Instagram. I'm purposely doing Instagram like the 1 minute thing. I'm not trying to do these long things. I'm just training myself, and I'm just doing this. Wake up, get people moving and stuff like that. I don't know. I'm just trying to perfect the 1 minute blurb. I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I'm working on it, you know. Okay, man. So
all right.
I'll check you next Thursday.
Okay. Take it easy.
Later.
Later.